Good evening and welcome to Live at Lane. I am Seirra Person, a mass communication major and a member of the class of 2017.
And I am Keyontae Wallace, a mathematics and physics major and a member of the class of 2018.
And tonight is a sad night. Do you know why, Keyontae?
Because it's the last episode of this season of Live at Lane.
So tonight we have very special guests. We have sociology professor William Rookstool and mass communication professor Dr. Samuel Miller.
But you forgot about our special guest.
Oh, yeah. And the special guest with the chirping sound. Yeah, that's our little birdie, Alfred.
Carlotta.
Well, that's actually subliminal. If you were actually hearing the bird right now, you might be going crazy.
As loud as he chirping, I know they can hear.
No, they're going crazy. I don't know what you're talking about.
Yeah.
So, how are you guys tonight?
Fantabulous.
Okay.
I am super plundiferous.
Oh. Big words. Guys, study your ACT word of the day, huh?
I had to.
That's okay. Amazing. So, where are you guys originally from?
It's my first.
Sure, why not?
Originally from the state of West Virginia, a very peculiar place. But it prepared me well for Lane College.
I'm originally from Pennsylvania, actually just north of him, in southwestern Pennsylvania, just south of Pittsburgh, a little town called Somerset.
Somerset.
Yes.
We have a mall in Michigan named Somerset.
There are a lot of places named after Somerset. It's mainly the sister city of a town in England.
Hmm. There's a lot of that in West Virginia too. Yeah. Summer. There's a lot of summers in the words, yeah.
So, what is your educational background like?
Educational background? I went to Concord University in the southern part of the state of West Virginia. Mm-hmm. Then I went to Marshall University, Thundering Herd, in Huntington, West Virginia for my master's degree, and I am currently working on a PhD soon to defend my dissertation for the PhD.
Okay, I went to Slippery Rock University from undergrad. That is a real place. Our mascot is a rock. That's how good we are at Slippery Rock. Then I got my master's at Georgia State University.
Go Bulldogs.
No.
It's not?
That's the University of Georgia. Yeah. We're the Georgia State University. We're Georgia State University. That's the Panthers.
Oh.
Yeah.
Well, teach me something.
Then. And then I finished up my PhD in 2016 up at the University of North Dakota.
Just all over the place.
Yeah.
So what brought y'all to Lane?
Well, mainly a job, because there are no jobs for educated persons in West Virginia.
So, amen.
You know, now I'm living it up here at Lane College.
All right, living it up.
I have been a transient since the age of 18. I have lived pretty much all over the country. This is pretty much just another stop. I have been in Pennsylvania, North Dakota, Arizona, as well. This is just another stop on the wonderful tour that is life.
So, what are some of you guys' interests outside of school or this campus, Lane College? Whatever you want to call
Well, some of my interests I probably shouldn't speak about on camera, but no, I'm a fairly boring person, as you can tell. No, I just, you know, kind of hang out with my family. You know, I have a daughter that I love dearly, and, you know, I kind of love my wife, too, a little bit.
Kind of.
Yeah. I just used her to get a daughter, basically. Yeah. No, I'm just joking. I don't know if, Crystal, you're going to watch this, but... But I hang out with my daughter a lot. Ever since she was born, she's really my life. So, yeah.
Well, for me, how long do you got? Because I've got a lot of interests outside of this. Because not only do I do all the things here, not as many as the things as Professor Peters, but between the fact that I am a seamstress, I do make stuffed animals.
Wouldn't it be seamster?
No, I prefer to have the title seamstress.
Oh, okay.
I like that better. So I make stuffed animals for money and profit, believe it or not, which seems really weird that this makes stuffed animals. I'm also a champion and world-renowned kendama player, which if you want to see that, I will gladly show in the credits later, but someone has to shoot that later. I also am an active rollerblader. I still skate quite often. Gotta stay young. As well as running 3 YouTube channels, amongst other things.
I rollerblade.
Other things.
Other Sorry. Things. Like, again, similar to Professor Rookstool, should not be said on camera.
So what did you guys do before coming to Lane College?
Well, I had a fairly uneventful career teaching in West Virginia, teaching students that, much like Lane College, don't really like to learn. No, I'm just joking. The job fell through, and I was out of work for quite a while, but I delved into my interest more during that time period. So.
For me, I was wrapping up my PhD in North Dakota, where I got to basically sit around and watch cartoons all day and call that a dissertation. Because in academia, if you can form the right question, you can pretty much do what you want in terms of research. So while my friends were doing serious things like crisis communication and performance communication, I'm sitting around watching cartoons and calling it a life.
Anything to get those grants, hey.
It's amazing what you can do with it.
Okay. That's a true profession.
So, right? What are some projects that you both are working on?
I am finishing up a spirituality study, hopefully to defend it very, very soon. And some other projects, I have more interest in some other types of studies. I really need to publish some articles, but probably related to spirituality, since that's my specialization, spirituality in higher education.
As for me, I've currently submitted an article for publication to Men and Masculinities concerning my research. When I said I was watching cartoons, I primarily watch My Little Pony, which is hilarious for a lot of people. That is what I research. I research the fandom, and a lot of what I deal with is how they are constructing our current understandings of masculinity. And so my current article that I just sent out deals with how they have created a new framework for masculinity, which goes beyond what we currently understand in that field, as well as a second article that I'm almost ready to put out regarding self-disclosure practices within the fandom. So on top of everything else that I do, I love to read a lot of dusty old books and write.
Okay. All right, well, that's all the time we have for right now. So we're going to take a quick break, and then we're going to come back and get more details.
More? Really? Cool.
Welcome back to Live at Lane. I am Keyontae Wallace, and
I'm Seirra Mercy.
And we are back with Live at Lane with Dr. Miller and Dr. Rookstool.
Hi, everybody.
So we're going to get back into these questions.
You comfortable?
I am. Thank you.
Oh, okay.
So what are some things that are on you guys' bucket list? Just some things that you want to knock out of the way before you croak over.
Croak over.
Yeah.
That's an interesting euphemism that you just made.
Yeah.
I guess I'll go first. I've pretty much done everything that I've wanted to do, which is pretty long list, but about the only thing that I really have my heart set on doing is I want to be able to hit a home run out of a major league ballpark. I don't care if it's cheating with a T-ball set and a rubber ball. I just want to be able to do it once if I can do that, because I have caught a home run ball at the home run derby in 2006 in the Allegheny River. I was in a boat. That was fun. Brad Ausmus hit it in the first round of the home run derby, and I caught it.
That's nice.
Yeah.
So what about you?
I don't really have a bucket list necessarily, but if I had to have at least something on my bucket list, probably to try to conquer my fear of heights. Mm-hmm. I've always had a fear of heights. But one of these days, if I can trust anyone around here, I would be willing to maybe partner with someone and maybe tandem skydive out of a plane or something.
I actually went skydiving.
Even if I pass out, I still want to do it.
So. At least you could say you did. Ooh.
That's right.
It's like you get that tingling feeling once you get too high, and then it's like you just clench up. Because I do that every time I get on roller coasters. But
I was going to ask that question. Have you done roller coasters?
Yes.
And you can handle them?
Really?
Can you?
Yeah, okay. For the most part.
Like, what's the biggest roller coaster you've ever been on?
It's been a while.
Was it at Cedar Point?
No, it wasn't Cedar
Ooh,
Point.
Ooh, Top Steel Dragster. That's my favorite ride.
No, it was, this was back in the 90s, mm-hmm. The Draken Fire in Williamsburg.
Okay.
Virginia.
Oh, so Busch Gardens. So,
yeah, Busch Gardens. It had like six loops in it. Yeah.
Yeah. I'm a thrill ride seeker myself. Mainly it's usually when my mother finds out about a new scary ride, I have to go with her because she's pushing 70.
You have a very strange relationship with your mom.
I do. I actually do. We have a very beautiful relationship. It's
well, you are from the mountains.
Yes.
All, so I understand that.
Yes, especially you from West Virginia. We understand that relationship with your mother.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Actually, I never had a relationship with my mother. But
oh, that's sad.
Yeah. I had more of a relationship with my father.
Okay.
Which might be even more strange, actually.
Yeah, maybe. Especially considering the number of sheep in West Virginia as well.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Quite a bit of those.
Yeah. That's somewhat bad.
So, what are some changes that you've witnessed throughout your years here at Lane?
You've been here longer than me.
Positive or negative changes?
Positive.
Well,
let's go with good news first.
Let's do good news first. Positive change. I've seen a lot of positive changes at Lane. Been here for 5 years, enough to see a transition from one president to the next. And mm-hmm. And I would love to say that President Hampton is doing a great job. And that's not just for job security, me saying that.
totally understandable.
He's doing a terrific job. I've seen a lot of changes in the culture itself, in the students. And it's getting very exciting around here. And I'm glad to be a part of the transition, the change. So I know. I'm sweet like that.
Yeah, it's adorable.
Yeah.
So for me, I've only been here, this is the end of my first year here, and I haven't seen quite the transition that Rookstool has had, but I will say this, the level of commitment that I've seen within our department here in Mass Comm, just to polish our apple a little bit, has been outstanding. Yeah, you take that dust off your shoulder, it's beautiful. It's been a wonderful experience to see how much growth has come out. But I will say this in conjunction with what you mentioned about Hampton. I recently came back from a presentation that I gave in Oklahoma, where they invited me to talk about my research. So I was at another university talking about it, and I was talking to the members of that communication department. And one of the things that we are, And I'm not joking when I say this, blessed to have here is that we have the support of our president. And there are some places where, you know, various departments do not get that support. And the fact that, you know, President Hampton wants to see this department grow and is trying his best to make sure that happens is a blessing, because when you're in a situation where that does not exist, it's damaging to you. It's like all your efforts are in vain, mm-hmm. and you're trying to help improve a place. So I will say this, the fact that we've had this growth, not only in the maturity of our students, but actually the number of students who come in and actually work on productions, like even the fact that this exists, is a real good step up from apparently where you guys started, what, in a two rooms
at the top of the library.
Yeah, so I think that's phenomenal in and of itself.
Okay, so Professor Rookstool, is it true you break dance?
I break dance maybe not well. I guess it's a subjective opinion here. I can only break dance to one song, and that song is, I know everyone is dying to know what the song is. It is by Peaches and Herb, Shake Your Groove Thing. It's the only song that I can dance, break dance to.
Interesting. Okay.
The only song I can break dance to.
See, when she said break dancing, I was thinking maybe when you dance, something breaks, whether it's property or a body part.
I'm getting to be that age, yes.
Getting to be that age.
I have to be more careful now.
Yeah, when you wake up, you might throw back out. Yeah.
Yeah.
That you can get back up.
That's right.
Otherwise, we need a medical alert. Sound like the old lady from the 80s.
I've fallen, and I can't get up.
I miss that lady, God rest her soul.
I'm not quite at that age yet, though.
Sometimes I wake up and I feel decrepit.
But sometimes it's good to get down and stay down, you know.
Amen to that.
So, Miller, is
yes.
it true that you skateboard?
Well, I don't skateboard. Don't confuse me with them. There are certain allegiances that you don't mess with. I do rollerblade, which does mean that not only do I roll around on eight wheels, I actually grind rails, do gaps. Some of the craziest things, and this is all in video, so if you really want to find me, you can do this. Some of the craziest things I've done include jumping off of a roof and transferring to another roof and then doing a 180 over a chain link fence. On top of that, I have done grinds the length of a city block on rails. Like, there's a nice rail out here on the hill that I'm dying to do, but because this is my job here, I can't.
I understand why you are the way you are now. Thank you for that clarification.
Yes. A lot of bumps on the head.
I've always. I wondered.
I have that thrill-seeking gene. It's an extension of what my mother gave me. But see, I have to do this more adventurous.
See, here he goes with his mother again.
Yeah. Always back to the mother. I mean, it's better than my daddy issues.
Well, unfortunately, this is all the time we have for this segment.
No.
We'll be right back with Live at Lane.
Promise?
We promise.
Okay.
And welcome back to Live at Lane.
Where apparently we just get comfortable.
Yeah, we do.
You're not too comfortable on this set.
I'm feeling good. Hope you're feeling good.
But we're back with Professor Miller. Oh, Dr. Miller.
Hi.
And Dr. Rookstool.
All right, yeah. I'll be nice.
So, what are some things that you guys are looking for to the mass communication
department?
Say that question again.
What are some things that you guys are looking forward to in the mass communication department?
Okay, the things that I'm looking forward to in the mass communication department is the continued growth of our department. We have, I don't know how this happened, and I'd like to know where they're all hiding. Apparently, before the semester began last fall, we doubled our numbers from around 40-some-odd to close to 100. I'm assuming most of them are first-year students hiding in the liberal arts stuff, because most of the time we try to get them involved in their general core first before we start introducing them to the major. I've been impressed by that, and hopefully what that's going to entail with that growth is more productions, in a sense that we will now have teams. So it's not just the same core, although I do enjoy a core, because a core group is always dependable. But by having it at least multiple groups that we know, hey, we got this production here for the basketball game, we got this production here for the football, or we have a special for Founders Day, things like that. That's one of the things that I'm looking forward to, is that we get so big that we can actually build the department as one of the crown jewels of the school.
And what are some things that you are looking forward in the sociology department?
Well, now that I'm chair of the Department of Sociology, I'm going to speak for the whole department. We are, hopefully, I would like to see some more interdisciplinary actions between sociology and maybe mass communication.
Thank you, yes.
Maybe between sociology and physical education, in terms of maybe introducing meditation, or maybe an introduction to a yoga class, or something of the like. I would love to do a panel discussion at some point, Maybe I could start with a social problem, and then someone could narrow it down, Dr. Stewart, maybe on a more specific topic, such as communication problems in relationships within the family institution, and then maybe the mass communication department can jump in somewhere.
Oh, definitely.
Yeah.
Because that's one of my secret powers. I'm a theorist, primarily, even though I'm pretty much here for the writing. A lot of the stuff that I do actually interacts a lot with his department as well. So yeah, I'd be totally up for that.
Yeah.
That's a good thing. Which I also believe is something that we should be doing more often in most colleges to begin with. Interdisciplinary is always a good thing.
Liberal arts institution,
yes, definitely.
Definitely. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
So, for both of you guys, what changes are being made for the sociology department and mass communication department?
Yeah, Mr. Chair, what are you doing?
Quite a few changes, I guess. We're trying to be more objective in our measurements of students' outcomes, student success. We have been the third largest major in the college since I've been here. The numbers are staying steady. I would like to say that in the past 5 years, I've seen the numbers go up a little bit. I don't know if that's a coincidence or not, you know, since I've been here, but you think so?
Yeah.
No, I don't think so.
No, I think it's the truth. Usually when...
Now, you've only been here a year. So,
right, but yeah. Still, I would still argue the point that when you get good educators, students are going to gravitate towards that.
Well, I can agree with that because I had Rookstool in one class and then I just kept on taking them.
Yeah, I'm addictive like that. Yeah.
You get a sample and then they keep coming back for more, huh?
That's right.
Yep. Know how that goes. I'm surprised they come back to me. That's the scary
I'm
part.
I'm surprised too, really.
I know. Especially the nicknames that get me around here. Mm. You know, you would think that, you know, they would run away from me. But just like Brian Adams, they're going to run to you.
So what is your favorite part of your job?
The torture.
I know it is for you. I heard about the assignments you get.
Apparently, I have gained the reputation as being the toughest professor in the department. I don't know about the campus. I would like to think that I'm not, because I really don't think that what I'm doing is quite that rigorous, although I do push my students, because there's a difference between giving the student busy work and actually pushing them to their limits. I'd like to think that my students are being pushed that way so that they can go beyond what they think their potential is. Because I've always felt that, you know, the professors that I've always hated the most in terms of the work were actually the most rigorous and the ones that I've actually enjoyed. Because they pushed me to a level that I didn't think I had. And I have lovely stories about that in grad school. But I won't share them here.
I've experienced that too with a lot of my favorite teachers. I didn't know were my favorite at the time until afterwards, mm-hmm. and I realized that they had pushed me to a degree that I needed to be pushed, and now I get to pass that along. Mm-hmm. But my favorite part really is the teacher-student interaction in the classrooms. That's really where I'm more myself is in the classroom.
So, question to you two, and you don't have to answer one of us, because that's fine. Who are your favorite professors?
Well,
and I know the one in the control room is probably going to have a field day if you don't say her name.
Well, I ain't going to say her name because she became not my favorite professor.
And why
this
is that?
Semester.
Wow. A little bit of drama here.
Well, yes.
Is this in regards to the surveys course?
Yes,
that
but
I am also a part of.
Yes, so both of y'all are on that, you know, that
yes!
list right now. So
makes me feel good.
But I mean, I'm overall, like, I would have to say my teacher was probably Dr. Perry. I had her my freshman year.
She is sweet.
And I couldn't get along with her for nothing. But then I had her again my junior year, mm-hmm. and I loved her, and I appreciate everything she did.
See, and you're probably going to feel some type of way, but I have two. And the first one is Dr. Hicks. Oh, no. I'm sorry, not Dr. Hicks. That was one of my favorite professors. But Miss Nicole Anderson, well, Hicks now, and Dr. Pogi, because that's like my mentor in a way. But yeah. And unfortunately, we have came to the end of this segment for Live at Lang. We will be back, and back with full force.
You mean Gene, I'm here to take the championship belt.
Well, welcome back to Live at Lang. And I'm Seirra Person, along with
Keyontae Wallace.
And we have a new person here, Professor Peters, Pamela Peters.
Hey.
Take her classes. No, I'm just playing. Y'all take her classes. But yeah, she has joined us on the set so she can get in this good old hot chair and we can get to know her
personally. Before you go, all the years of production, that's your intro? Hey.
Yeah, I wasn't on camera.
Oh yeah, we also have
I was the producer.
Dr. Rookstool and Dr. Miller.
Yeah, they here too.
We forgot about
these,
them.
These two schmoes sitting over here for the last 30 minutes. You know, now we got the real person.
Yeah.
You know,
get the scrubs out.
It is what it is. So,
I know. Well, you are VIP, I know.
Hey. They pulled me out of the control room for this.
Yeah, I saw
you've been back there all semester. They need to see the masterminds behind this. They see one, they have to see you too.
What are you talking about? I just show up.
So do I. We let you guys do everything.
Oh, okay.
Have you not figured that out in the time that we've been doing this?
No.
So I got a proclamation. How about getting to these questions?
That's better than I have a question.
I can actually throw this question at you, Professor Peters. So what are some things in the up and coming next semester projects? Anything that are going to be occurring with the mass communication.
And you better say the same assignment that I had in surveys.
Oh, don't worry. The webpage assignment will definitely be around, not next semester, but the following semester. Miller and I've had fun with it. I've had a lot of fun with it. Miller has just kind of come on at the last second to help me with the writing part. I don't know what's going to happen. You guys know I come up with things off the top of my head and
don't
say, let's do it. Hopefully we'll continue the Burroughs show next semester with JEA. We'll continue to do football. We are actually going to have students call football games next year like we did with basketball this year. That about gave me a heart attack this year, but it worked out well. You never know. We will hopefully continue this show. Maybe eventually in the next couple years do a newscast. My hope is in the next 5 years that we'll actually do a documentary filmmaking class. Documentary filmmaking, besides sports broadcasting, documentary filmmaking is kind of my baby. I've actually had a couple of award-winning documentaries, so I'd like to get back into that. And to have students do that, it would be fun.
So yeah. Let's go back to the top, because we really don't know anything about her.
You don't need to know anything about me.
Where do you originally come from? Because
Kansas.
You never really get
answered it.
Actually, believe it or not, I was born in Pennsylvania.
Oh yeah, that part.
Somewhere close to you.
Oh boy.
I know, it's a scary thought.
It explains a whole lot.
And I moved to Kansas when I was about 2, and I grew up in a small town of less than 500 in Kansas. I've been asked here since I've been here, did we have a bathroom? Yes, we had a bathroom. I did not have to use the outhouse.
But there was only one bathroom.
But there was only one bathroom. So yeah, I grew up in a small town called Richmond, Kansas, and went to Pittsburgh State University for my undergrad and my master's. Worked
Sorry,
in broadcasting.
Please, you're, thank
Dude,
you.
You're gonna mess. You won't follow. Now I worked at Walmart and then I came here. So, you know, I've kind of been around. Not as much as this one, but yeah.
So, what is your educational background?
As far as my master's and undergrad.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's my master's and undergrad, my undergrad was in mass communication with an emphasis in broadcasting. As a college student, you know, these guys complain to me all the time, I give them too much work. As a college student, I was usually doing 2 to 3 productions a week. I was the producer of our sports broadcasting program. And then during my master's, I was the executive producer of Caps 13, which was our TV station. and I ran the sports broadcasting along with the professor, and I also ran the news show. So you all think my work ethic's just crazy because I'm here. I've always had a weird and strange work ethic.
So what brought you to Lane College?
I needed a job.
See how much we compliment one another.
I was working at Walmart, and Lane College offered me a job, and it sounded a lot better than being a cashier the rest of my life. So
you was probably not even cashiering.
No, by the time I left, I was actually. By the time I left, I was actually in the photo center, and I was the backup customer service manager up front. I don't know who thought that was a good idea, but.
What are you talking about? You have excellent people skills.
So what Moving are some on. Of your interests outside of Lane College?
I like to travel. I like to hike. I hike for relaxation. I travel a lot. Last summer, I actually just released a book on my trip to Costa Rica. I've also got a book that I did on my trip to Kenya a few years ago. I try to every year pick at least a country to visit or a couple of national parks within the United States. One of my goals is to visit all the national parks in the U.S. before I'm 40. Mm-hmm. May or may not happen.
A lot.
If you count battlefields, it's a lot. And I've been to well over 40 at this point. And I'm only 31, so I've got a ways to go. But, you know, I hike, I write, I've written two novels, so, you know. I'm adventurous, but not in the way Miller is.
You only live once.
So what are some things on your
I feel like
bucket
this has become my
list.
Show.
It sort of has, but we're fine. You know, because we're just doing scrubs. Let this thing roll a little bit longer back there.
Yeah,
by
we got
the
a
way.
Few more segments,
yeah.
By the way, guys.
Yeah, you're gonna be fine. Just roll for 20 minutes.
What are some things on my bucket list? One of my big things. I would like to do a trek across Nepal. I don't want to climb Mount Everest, but I want to see Mount Everest on that trek. However, the problem is they've got these bridges that stretch, and I don't like cable bridges. I have a fear of heights, but as a photographer, you kind of have to get over that. You know, when you're standing on the edge of the Grand Canyon photographing, you kind of have to get over the fact that it's a mile drop.
Again, interdisciplinary right here.
Yep.
The height fear.
Appalachian Trail.
Yep.
There you go.
I've done that. Trail. That wasn't, yeah. One of my other goals, I want to hike across the Milford Track in southeastern New Zealand. That's my ultimate goal, is to hike that, which will take about 4 to 5 days.
So what is your favorite part about your job?
This job here or my photography? No, just messing
with. Which job? Make the right choice.
We asked you to do the same
well,
thing
you know,
on set
well, you know,
professor.
As a wildlife photographer, sometimes it's pretty similar. The only difference is the animals I encounter could kill me, and I don't think the students will, so I'm pretty good there. But I love
Except
interacting. I love interacting with the students. I love teaching. I always said growing up I would never become a teacher. That was my one goal. I was never going to become a teacher, and now I'm a teacher. But I love interacting with students. I love getting to do things like this. So.
Okay.
Yeah, this isn't a job to me either.
No, it's fun. If it were a job, I would dread coming to work.
Yeah, I don't get a case of the Mondays.
Sometimes I do, but it's rare.
I don't.
When I have to do those games till 11, 12 o'clock at night with these
Especially
guys, sometimes
Tuesdays
I dread
that.
Especially
on Tuesdays when I go to my classroom and I see him setting up.
What are you
well,
saying?
We're going to wrap
you,
up.
You brighten up my day, man.
Segment.
I'm not welcome back.
Just got you caught up, so now you're at their level.
You know.
So
that's what this was.
Yeah.
So are you emerging from the dark side now?
So we're going to take a break, and then we're going to come back and
so I can leave now.
No, you're stuck here.
You're stuck in the seat.
So,
we've got some more questions for you.
And welcome back to Live at Lane. I am Seirra Person along with
Keyontae Wallace.
And you are live at the Lolling
Pin. We have Professor Pamela Peters, Dr. Samuel Miller, and Professor William Rookstool.
Hi, Dad.
And I hope my parents don't
and
watch this show.
Interesting
I'll forward it to them.
On our
I don't even
last
know.
Episode. So.
I'm impressed by their
well, for Professor Peters and Dr. Miller. What is it about mass communication that you find so interesting to teach?
Well,
you start.
Okay. For mass communication on my angle, I'm primarily here for the writing segment of courses, which a lot of students do not find all that fun and amusing, especially my comm law class, which, a warning for all of you who are looking to take comm law next semester, next year, I'm going to make it tougher, because that's just how I'm doing it, because apparently I'm not doing enough, and I feel that I need to push them just a little bit more. Again, back to that envelope, I know where their ability levels are, and I think I can get a little bit more out of them. I'm actually more of a theory guy, so when he started talking about interdisciplinary studies, that kind of excites me, the fact that I'd love to talk about that sort of thing. Like, my focus is more in interpersonal communication and gender studies, and that's where I'd like to go. Get theory courses involved. So be glad you're leaving.
What was the question? He lost me.
Something that you find interesting in teaching.
What I find interesting about teaching, if you guys haven't figured out, I don't like to sit still. I don't sit still. I always need to be thinking about something. I always need to be doing something. So what I like teaching here, and teaching in general, is I love to create stories. I love to tell stories, and to pass it on to the students is fun, even though sometimes I think they think I'm crazy. And there are times that they look at me like I'm crazy. They want, like right now. And I just enjoy the fact that things are always changing. You know, what I was doing 10 years ago in college with broadcasting has completely changed. When I was in broadcasting 10 years ago in college, we were turning digital. Now everything's digital. And it's the constant need to keep up. You know, people sometimes question if I have enough, if I do anything in my free time besides what I do. Or if I have free time, a lot of my free time spent actually catching up and learning about the new technology that's out there, because broadcasting is always changing, and I love that. It's exciting. So,
Professor Rookstool, what is it about sociology that you find interesting?
That it explains everything.
About the two of us.
Yeah. Oh, as far as the teaching part?
No, I'm saying what makes it so interesting that you would actually want to.
That it explains everything. It's all about experience. And I do enjoy the interaction with the students, and I can't sit still either when I'm in the classroom. I have to watch.
I can't sit still right now. Yeah. It's driving me nuts.
That's how we think, I guess. We think better by.
I don't know that I even fully sit still
sleeping.
Huh? Yeah.
I've heard of that about you.
Yeah.
Whereas I like to just sit back and just sort of pontificate about whatever it is I'm talking about, because I got a stroke of my.
Because he doesn't even know what he's talking about.
That's right. I really don't. They hired this maniac.
That's part of the exclusive club.
That's right.
It is. We just fake it.
Little known fact: when they interviewed me for this job, I had just removed the tinfoil off my head.
Somehow,
to make sure
that
the conspiracies weren't going to saturate my brain while I was trying to look normal for Dr. Stewart and Dr. Coleman during the interview process.
Okay, so if you guys had the opportunity to create or teach a specific course that would be something that you're interested in, what would it be? And that's for all three of you guys.
I'll let you know first, because I got a real doozy.
I've created a bunch already.
I think
I'm pretty much always creating something new. We're always testing something down here to see if it's going to work.
To the detriment of the students.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the students sometimes, it's like we start the semester and I think they want to know, what did she come up with? 2 weeks over Christmas break, I had a lot of free time, so it was like, what did she come up with? So we had a whole class on how to develop a media web page. If I had something I really could develop and teach, would it be a documentary filmmaking class. Like I said, I love documentary filmmaking. I actually have a documentary that I did in college that a friend and I are looking at going back and redoing. It was actually aired on national television in Germany. I like to brag about that. So, I'd love to teach documentary filmmaking.
Das ist Deutschland. Go
ahead. What was the question?
If you had the chance to teach or create a specific class, what would be?
Actually,
thank you. You did it for me.
Actually, I
think it would be the study of Miller.
That's the whole project in itself.
You took the words right out of my mouth. No. Hey, and then you could teach a performance class or something about that. Hey, I could be the more theoretical side, and you all could be
the theory, all the performance. Yeah.
That would work out very well, yes. Interdisciplinary, see?
There you go.
No, honestly, mine would probably be spirituality and sociology of spirituality and religion. Since it's not taught, we're supposed to have a religion course within the discipline of sociology, but it's never taught. So I would like to take that over. I would like to teach that.
Race and reconciliation.
The
course that's actually being taught. That's the actual course. Because it deals with theories and religion, literally. And
The religion department has sort of taken that over, I think.
Race reconciliation, yeah.
But I'm in that course. But we need more of the sociological perspective, too, on spirituality and religion.
Oh, we have a lot of theologians in that course. Yeah.
Not from a theological perspective, a sociological perspective.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. That's different, so.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Primarily for me, it would be, I have two or three. One would be a gender and communication course, because gender studies is my bread and butter. Pop culture course, primarily how audiences participate within our communities. So like with the stuff that I did in my dissertation and things like that, I'd love to teach. And I'd love to eventually, and we've been working on the remapping for our program, I eventually want to have an advanced theory course where we talk about like a lot of communication theory that plays a major role in how we understand the world. Mm-hmm.
So what are some things happening now at school that you see are making a big impact on the department and the school?
A big impact on the department and the school.
Alfred.
Exactly.
Yeah, I thought he was gone.
Yeah, Alfred definitely. He's made a big impact.
He's made a big impact on this show.
Because he's on Pearson's last good nerve.
He really is. Like, I'm about to make chop suey.
I spent all afternoon trying to get him out of the building. I apologize.
Well, that's fine, because he'll still be in here in the morning.
I got his friend out this morning for you. So what's making a big impact? I've been here 6 years now, and I think there's more freedom now. You know, you see that there's a lot more academic freedom. We get to do more. We get to develop more, you know, like you guys were talking earlier before I showed up. We used to operate this out of a library, out of two rooms in the library. And now we're in a building of our own that we collect birds, obviously. And, you know, but we have a building that, you know, we're able to operate out of. We're starting to develop the radio program. We're developing a TV program. I've noticed when I go out around town, Lane itself is creating a different image for itself, mm-hmm. and it's positive. And I enjoy that, because it used to be when I would tell people I worked at Lane, they'd just look at me, you know, and you work at Lane? What are you thinking? Now when you say I work at Lane, people seem more, you know, it's not a shock to them, I guess you could say, which I think that's positive for the school. And it's exciting to see, and it's also positive for the department. You know, the fact that we're working in conjunction with JEA, and we have students working at some of the local stations. So it's exciting to be
a part of that process.
It is exciting,
and we've been here long enough that we've seen the evolution of
we've seen the
academic freedom. I can speak to that too with the. I'm glad we have the academic
freedom. Yeah, sometimes I kind of am afraid they give me too much freedom, but I'm okay with that because, you know, it lets the students experience more.
Sure.
Ditto. So.
And they are the guinea pigs.
So, they are. You guys definitely are the guinea pigs.
Thank you for that, by the way.
Yeah. Okay, so what is something that you really want your students to remember after completing one of your courses?
Miller, take it.
Okay. hopefully a little bit more than some of the fun things that I talk about in class, which there are stories of those floating around, including the iPhone, Gerber baby food, things like that, which are all interesting stories about in and of themselves. Really, you know, even though I might have been really, you know, I pushed them hard, that at least what they got out of it was something rewarding. Like, I know my comm law students despise the case briefs that I make them do, but they're learning the process on how we have gotten to this point in First Amendment and free speech, that, you know, how we are even allowed to broadcast the way that we do. So that's one thing I really want them to take away. That, you know, even though I was I pushed them hard, they're grateful for that, because then everything else looks easy after the fact, which is what you should think about when you take this her class.
Yeah, I mean, I want students to remember, because usually what I hear from students is how hard it is. You know, all the work, all the labor that goes. I want students to understand broadcasting isn't just you show up, flip a camera on, and you go. I want students to understand there's a lot of work into it. There's a lot of strategy that goes into it. You know, for like down here, you know, people, when we started the show, it's like, well, all the lights are set up, we just have to show up and do a show. And that's not it. When we do a ball game, you know, I want the students to understand not only the production side of it, the engineering side of it. Mm-hmm. If you were to work for, you know, students complain because we're there 8 to 12 hours in a day, and you've been there for several of those, and they think that's a lot of work. If you work on a production for, say, ESPN, you may be there 4, 5, 6 days. Mm-hmm. So I want them to understand it's a lot of work, but I want them to also understand that I'm not doing this to torture you guys. It's because this is real world experience. I want you guys to have that real world experience.
But we do get a kick out of it.
There's a slight bit of enjoyment out of it.
Sure.
But, you know, and I love doing it. And I want you guys to, my goal is, when you get a degree in this, I want you to understand before you leave, especially doing broadcasting, that it is a lot of work. I don't want a student to leave after 4 years doing broadcasting and then go out in the real world and say, you didn't teach me this, and I don't want to do this. It's not what I want to do. So, you know, I have had students come to me and say in the last 2 years, you know, Professor Peters, I don't want to do broadcasting. It's a lot more work than I thought. Because a lot of students take mass comm thinking it's easy. And so it is easy, you know, because I took mass comm because I wasn't good at math. And I thought, I'm going
to
do mass comm because
Amen
I can't do math. I'm not good at math. It's the truth.
I don't do quantitative research either.
You know, yeah, I can't do quantitative research. I can only do qualitative. So
don't talk to me about stats.
The way my brain works is very visual.
Okay.
So I want students to understand it can be easy, but it's a lot of work. And I think you have learned that over last couple years. It's a lot of work, but it's worth it. Mm-hmm. I hope you think it's worth it.
Mm. I appreciate it. I do. I just didn't like it, but I appreciate it. So what about you, Professor Rookstool?
Well, our departments are very complementary
are.
In that respect. You're mm-hmm. speaking of qualitative. I do more quantitative. not that I'm necessarily a math person, but quantitative is easier in a lot of ways.
Numbers matter.
Yeah.
I'm not saying math is power.
A positivist would say that.
I'm not arguing that numbers don't matter. I'm just saying my brain doesn't function that way.
Math lives matter.
I agree.
High score in Pac-Man matters.
Everybody's here for a certain reason. Mm-hmm. You know, but, I can learn math, but if you get me past 2 + 2, it's...
I can do my taxes.
I can do my taxes. That's pretty good.
I can't do my taxes.
Do your taxes.
Well, I have a second business, and she does too,
yeah,
We have special issues
to deal with, but
they definitely have issues.
we don't wow, argue that.
No, we don't.
We know, but we both know it, and yeah. For some reason it works well.
Somehow.
We have no clue why.
All right. Well, we're going to take a little short break, and when we come back, it's going to be the last segment. So there will be no more questions.
Oh, we get to ask you?
Okay, cool.
All right.
Take the break.
Stand by for the next round.
And welcome back to the very last segment of the very last episode of the semester of Live at Lane. I'm Seirra Person.
And I'm Keyontae Wallace.
And we're here with Dr. Miller, Professor Peters, and Professor Rookstool.
Dr. Rookstool.
Yeah, give him the props.
Let's give it to him.
And he's ABD, you might as well give it to him, Dr.
It's pretty much
point.
The same thing.
We'll give it to you.
So, I just want to say, you know, thanks to y'all for coming on to the show tonight.
I feel like I've been...
Hijacked?
Yeah, really, I do.
It was very fun, like, you know...
I'm glad you thought so.
Yeah, you're hilarious.
You really are.
Doggone hilarious.
I'm going to blush
he's
now.
Reading? Oh.
Yeah, he's the shade tree right there.
Man, I'm telling you.
And you just pop up, huh? Yeah.
I don't know. You guys pulled me out of the control room. I was back there just enjoying myself, relaxing. And somebody said, hey, let's mic her up.
When a couple of guys came out. I was only going to start making a Fresh Prince reference.
And I noticed
whatever.
I didn't even get something to drink tonight, you know.
Nah. After that project, nah, you don't get no drink.
You may thank me in a few years.
I would think you would.
So, is there anything you guys would like to say?
Well, I actually have a couple of questions, but I'm going to...
For me?
No. you've been working at WBBJ, correct?
Yes.
And you have been enjoying that. And you mentioned when you had the interview with Owens, you mm-hmm. said you would just like to kick back for a while before you pursue. Now, are you going to keep going with WBBJ, or do you have other plans?
I really want to, like, WBBJ is more of a starter.
Right.
It is
a small market, which
so,
is a good start.
I mean, I'm grateful for the opportunity, but I would like to branch out. I would like to go to a bigger station and, you know, see how that is. And being that I've worked in a news station, mm-hmm. I think I kind of want to give, like, maybe a television studio or something like that, knowing that I just got thrown into production. So now, I love doing production, so I would actually want to be on a production set, like in a movie or a TV show or something like that. Mm-hmm. So I just want to, you know, like, I don't want this to just, like, be my life. I want to expand and spread my wings a little bit.
So since you had to throw that out there at me, I threw you into production.
You did.
What would... If you were to come back 5 years from now, what would you want to see happening here?
If I came back, I would want to see, like,
probably
I want to see us, like, be out there. Like, I want to see us still doing Live at Lane, and I want it to be on people's TV at night or during the daytime or something. I want to see our games on somebody's TV. I just want to see it get bigger and better because... I know we came from a very, very small place to now we got a whole building that we can actually be like, that's home, a home away from home because we spend time in here. We don't have to go to the library and be, not saying that we want to be isolated from everybody, but work that we do, we can't necessarily get done in the library because when you're trying to edit a project, you need to, you know, hear it and you can't necessarily be that loud in the library.
Yeah, my office doesn't really.
And of course, you know, eventually seeing a alumni version of.
I think I need to come back.
Host,
well,
know.
I want to know if you're going to do this next year.
Of course, I actually.
I'm going to call you out. We're calling you out
okay,
right now.
Okay, so they're calling me out. I will be doing Live at Lane next semester.
Is that a threat?
That is kind of a threat.
Because the fact that this was something different. And I'm all about being an individual and not actually dealing with just the norm. Because this was stepping out of my major and actually somewhat of stepping back out of my comfort zone because freshman year I did the Handicapped All-Star Challenge, which I hope comes back. And I enjoyed myself. So that was actually fun. And then this year I got to do Live at Lane. Yes, I screwed up like 2 episodes, but it was 2 out of 7.
But you're,
so
you know.
I improved.
But you're. Well, that's what I was going to tell you guys. So I'm kind of taking this away from you.
Sorry.
One thing I want to tell you guys, I'm going to brag on this a little bit about you guys because I don't brag a lot about y'all, and. you know, I've been giving you a hard time the last couple weeks because you've been struggling, but you're really doing good with it. You know, it isn't your major. And you guys have really, I'm very proud of this program. I'm very proud of the students because you guys have stepped up a lot. You know, like Sarah said, we came from nothing. And we were given an opportunity. I asked the students to step up and do something, don't cry. And you guys went from doing nothing to doing a whole lot. And, you know, my hope is that some of the underclassmen are watching this.
Yes.
And will, like you said, come out of the woodwork and take part in it. We never turn students away.
Absolutely not.
I love them when students come and ask, can we be a part of it? I just wish when those students come and say, can we be a part of it, we actually see them again.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm very proud of the students that are back in the control room right now. I'm very proud of...
don't get too carried away back there. We hear you.
I'm very proud of you guys here, the students that have done sports, because it's not easy. It's a lot of work. Mm-hmm. And you've been here tonight since we started, and it's a long night. And after all day at school, you guys step up and do this. You know, basketball, you guys are here all day at school, and then I keep you here till 11, 12 o'clock at night.
This is one of my back-to-back days. Thursday is usually class starts around 11. I don't end the class till about 9 o'clock.
I believe it.
Because of the race and reconciliation class.
No, I wanted to tell you guys that because you know I'm not emotional. So don't cry on me, though.
Yeah.
But, you know, I know I'm very proud of you. I believe Miller's very proud of you guys.
Yeah, somewhat.
You know. But I'm not going to brag on you
no,
guys
I love
too much because we still have a few weeks of school left and I want to make sure you guys make it through.
I don't have a few weeks. Get that right. I got 3 days, 4 days.
Hello? See your exit exam.
I already took
Tuesday
that.
For me?
I'm done.
I believe you have something you got to get past with the two of us before you graduate.
On Monday.
Oh.
Paper the whole city on your
head. I got this. My partner back there in the production room, we got this.
You got something.
There's,
you just don't know what it
there's
is.
There's a party going back on in the production room right now. I'm not
yeah.
sure what's
yeah,
going on
back
there.
Yeah, we got this. So, Rookstool, do you have anything?
I've greatly enjoyed this experience this evening. I was a little bit nervous at first, but, you know, these people are Looney Tunes, and I identify with that, too, so I've had a good time.
He's the laid back one of them.
Yeah. But Seirra, you're a very photogenic person.
Thank you.
And I wish you much success. And as for you,
yeah, we get to harass you for another year.
Maybe I'll actually watch the show now if you're going to host it.
He's hosted everyone except for one, so you know.
Yeah.
You know, we're working.
If you're the primary host, I'll definitely tune in.
Oh, don't give him too much.
Yeah. I think he can do it.
He's already getting a big head.
I was going to say, you know, I might have to move over because there's no space left for that head.
Here, let me slide
just
over
a little
for
bit.
You.
Well, you know, I did, you know, brought in the viewers.
I give you that. You guys
in something.
One thing we're gonna ask is that you guys share it on Facebook, share it on YouTube. It's on YouTube every week.
We only had 100 viewers at first. We have
over. Our first episode, we had over 400 viewers.
And that was the first one.
Now, 10 or 20 of them may have been me analyzing the show.
Yeah, critiquing, that's important.
But
you may even end up with your own show.
Oh, we may be getting Professor Owens on here with her own show next semester.
She's been talking about it.
Uh-oh.
We're working on
names
right now.
We're creating monsters.
So. And we're getting yelled at by our floor.
Yeah, exactly. Well, over there, making all that noise.
Well, since this is the last show, the last segment, the last episode for this season,
it's just
I want to let Sierra close it out for us.
Well, I don't know what to say.
Closing
like
time.
It's been live at Lane and we've been live. I mean,
it's been fun.
It was a very
it's
very
been real
fun,
too.
It's been real.
Yes.
It's been real.
I always keep it surreal though.
So
you keep it something.
I keep it surreal.
Hello.
So that's gonna be the end. I mean, you know, thank you for tuning in. Please tune in next semester
yes,
and